power. We want black 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 power. What do you want?
Nobody in the town has any use for him. Nobody likes him. Nobody wants him.
We don't want brotherhood. You keep the brotherhood.
The Negro is not the problem. The problem is what Negro connotates, what it stands for. The pigment of skin isn't the problem. The problem is that the Negro in this country today stands for venereal disease, prostitution, the numbers racket, and crime.
CBS reports, Black Power, White Backlash, with CBS News correspondent Mike Wallace.
Summer 1966 was a season of revelation for the white man in the North. For the first time, he began fully to comprehend the intensity of his feelings and his fears about the black man. For years, he had watched, smug and fascinated, as the trials of the Southern black and white were played out for him like some morality play on his television screen. But he remained a spectator, only half involved. Then came summer 1966. And as riots crackled through his cities, the Northern white man came to realize the depth of his confusion, his animosity, and fear. Black power was the catalyst, a phrase shouted by a 25-year-old revolutionary on a Mississippi highway. It was a rallying cry to Northern blacks mired in frustration and bitterness, a cry that sounded like a threat of violence, of vengeance, to a white man fed up with racial turmoil.
The violence struck not just where it was expected, in the humid ghettos of the major urban centers in Brooklyn, Chicago, Cleveland. Americans were stunned to learn the other unexpected datelines of violence, from Amityville, New York, to Menlo Park, California. Almost everywhere, it began with marches, demonstrations. Then it escalated to looting, Molotov cocktails, and occasionally to a sniper's bullets. The damage hasn't yet been totaled. It will run into the tens of millions. Arrests were in the thousands. The number of persons injured, unrecorded. At least 9 persons were killed. But the most serious casualty of all was the relationship between the black man and the white man. By summer's end, the Northern white was counter-marching, counter-demonstrating.
And at the end of summer, white political leaders up and down the nation on all levels were voicing their concern.
I've heard it said that the cause of civil rights has fallen backward in this past year. And those who are critical say that riots and violence have produced new waves of white resistance to further progress. That the civil rights movement itself is rent by factionalism and extremism. And vital civil rights legislation has apparently floundered in the Congress for this session. And political candidates running on a platform of never, never have defeated good men of moderate progressive views. Now, my fellow Americans, I would be less than honest with you if I did not say that in all of this, there is some grain of truth.
These guys have been in and out of trouble so much, you could fill a book. But unfortunately, the Supreme Court ruling, where we have to handle these characters like daffodils instead of the bums that they are, where we could throw them in a jail where they belong, no, we have to tap them on the wrist. Now, the other problem which caused this situation is the NAACP. Their continual announcements of planned demonstrations, their continual announcements of mass meetings, has worked these people up in a frenzy, these irresponsible hoodlums who the so-called civil rights workers are working in their behalf for first-class citizenship. Well, I think that NAACP should turn right around and start doing something about demonstrating against these undesirables in their own race and nationality.
I don't think I have ever seen as strong a reactionism as has occurred in Atlanta and in Georgia. I'm perfectly frank and honest about it. It has upset the status quo of established voting patterns in the state of Georgia that never before had been upset. The state went Republican for the first time in the last presidential election. It went that way entirely on the race issue. We will have major changes in the runoffs that are now coming up or in the general election this year. I wouldn't attempt to identify each one of them, but I would say that I have never seen as strong a reaction amongst the white citizen as there is at the present time.
That was Ivan Allen, the mayor of Atlanta, Georgia, a leading moderate on racial matters in his native South. He strongly favored and testified in behalf of the 1964 Civil Rights Bill. His city has long been looked on as remarkable for its progress in relations between the races. It is also the home of the national headquarters of SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee.
Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. We want black power. We want black power. We want black power. We want black power.
To Stokely Carmichael, a 25-year-old revolutionary born in the West Indies, educated at the best high school in New York, a college graduate with a degree in philosophy. It was here in Mississippi this summer that Carmichael, with his cry for black power, first became a national figure and, to many, a frightening one.
Every courthouse in Mississippi ought to be burned down tomorrow to get rid of the dirt and hair. Now, from now on, when they ask you what you want, you know what to tell them. What do you want? What do you want? What do you want? Everybody, what do you want?
I talked with Stokely Carmichael one night earlier this month in Atlanta. He wore an African toga given him by Sekou Touré of Guinea, a reminder, he said, of his African heritage.
I think that there's a realization in this country that black power is not just a mere slogan, nationally or internationally. It is real that black people can come together and start determining for their lives how they're going to live and controlling their economic and political lives.
Well, why talk about dynamite sticks if Molotov cocktails won't work? When you talk of black power, building a movement that will smash everything that Western civilization has created, when you say that black power should bring the country to its knees anytime it messes with the black man. And these are quotes from Stokely Carmichael. The picture has got to be, in the mind of white man and black man, one of a man who threatens violence.
On the contrary, if you say that you have to bring the country to its knees if it messes with a black man, you're saying that the only protection for black people is that they unite. So that when one black man is touched, because he's black, there's some protection for him. Now, it's obvious that that protection does not exist in this country. It does not now exist. And the only people who can have that protection are black people. And black people know that. Now, white people may not know that. So it means that you have to build a movement so strong in this country that if one black man is touched, every black man will rise up and let this country know they're not going to tolerate it.
If one black man is touched.
That's right, because he's black. I mean, if a black man is walking down the streets of Mississippi, down a highway with a Bible in his hand, he is shot because he is black.
That's one incident.
Oh, I can name you a lot of others, and you know that yourself.
In the northern ghettos.
If one black man in California is driving his pregnant wife to the hospital and he is shot by a white racist policeman, I can name you more incidents.
Then you're saying fight violence with violence.
I am saying that we must build a movement of black people that will protect ourselves so that we are willing to stop that by any means necessary. Now, I'm not concerned about the question of violence. It seems to me that that will depend upon how, in fact, white people respond. If white people, in fact, are willing not to bother with black people because they are black, then there's going to be no question of violence.
When you read stories about difficulties, riots in Omaha or Cleveland or Brooklyn or Chicago or wherever,
I call them rebellions.
They're rebellions.
That's right.
And you see nothing wrong with them?
I think that it is people who are rebelling against a system that has locked them inside tight of ghettos, that exploits and oppresses them, and they have no means of redress to break that system down. We intend to build within black people the realization that that problem is not theirs, that it's created by white society. It's purposely created by white society, and then they throw it back on us and blame us. That's the first thing we have to create in black people. Then secondly, we have to move to a position where we can control the housing in our neighborhoods so that we're not exploited, so that we're not charged high rents to share apartments with rats, and so that the owners of those apartments don't live in the suburbs grabbing the profits from us, that we're able to grab it, and that the money will be able to stay in our community so we can develop it. It is no different from a colony in Africa who is supposedly free, but her resources are controlled by the mother country. They have to move to a position to control the resources, and having done that, their problems are already solved.
And the means that you will use to achieve all of this?
What? Any means necessary.
Well, I know, but now, well, spell that out. What does that mean?
It means that we will develop tactics as we go along, and whatever those tactics are, we will use them.
Tactics? That means you've got to buy the buildings. You've got to start the businesses. You've got to train the people. How are you going to do that by yourselves? How are you going to do it without the help of the white community?
Well, the first help we'd need of the white community is just to turn over those buildings to us.
Turn them over?
That's correct. Turn them over.
You think that's likely, Mr. Carmichael?
Well, you asked me what help we wanted white people to give. Or they could buy it for us.
You mean Washington would buy it from, let's say, the slumlord and turn it over to you?
That's correct.
You believe, really, that that is the salvation of the black man?
I think that this country is run by property ownership, and that black people are not only propertyless, they are viewed as property. And we have to move to a position of property ownership in this country so that we can bargain from a position of strength with racists rather than a position of weakness.
You're one black man who went to a good, essentially white high school in the city of New York.
That's
you
correct.
Obviously had had a good education.
That's
a good many of the people who work with you here in SNCC can say the same thing.
And we're saying that...
And you're a black man who came from a New York ghetto.
And we're saying that there's a system that allows for one or two black people to get out. And that that's the rationale for keeping other black people down.
And it has nothing to do with the unwillingness or inability of the Negro to help himself and to work hard.
That's the rationale, that the reason why black people aren't this is because they're lazy, unambitious, stupid, have rhythm, and they eat watermelon.
You call on the black man to refuse to respond to his draft call.
That is correct. And we will continue to do so while there's breath in our bodies.
Do you really believe that the military policies of the United States are designed to exterminate the black man, as you've said?
I most certainly do. I look at the recent statement by racist McNamara, who says that 30% of the people that are going to be drafted now under his new system are going to be black people. And that's nothing more than black urban removal.
The white liberal, who supported civil rights for so long with time and effort and money, what is your feeling about him?
Well, I think that there's no reason why they should stop supporting the movement now. I certainly feel that if they're genuinely interested in black people, and since black people have charted a course, they believe in that program, they will continue to give to it. They need more white people to civilize whites. They need them to civilize the savages in Cicero, who throw rocks and bricks at a peaceful and lovable black man like Dr. Martin Luther King, who would not even hurt a fly. And that's very important, because our uncles and our fathers and our older brothers died in World War I fighting Nazism to protect the Poles, and those same Poles turn around and throw rocks and bricks at us after we died to save their lives. And people talk about we are savages.
Mr. Carmichael, if you had the chance to stand up in front of the white community and say anything you desired, say to him, understand me, white man, what would you say?
I would say, understand yourself, white man, that the white man's burden should not have been preached in Africa, but it should have been preached among you. That you need now to civilize yourself. You have moved to destroy and disrupt. You have taken people away. You have broken down their systems. and you have called all that civilization, and we who have suffered at this are now saying to you, you are the killers of the dreams. You are the savages. Yes, it is you who have always been uncivilized. Civilize yourself.
This young man who calls upon the white man to civilize himself had a radical effect on the civil rights movement with his cry of black power. Not only did it produce a predictable reaction in the white community, but it added to the strains within the movement itself. The five leading civil rights groups range from the conservative NAACP and the Urban League to CORE and SNCC, by far the most militant. Although they will not criticize each other publicly, leaders of the various groups inevitably are caught up in a popularity contest, and they are acutely aware of the need to present a public posture of militancy. This summer, Martin Luther King was on the defensive.
His open housing drive in Chicago was not getting results, and so the people of SNCC and CORE began to sneer at the fruitless demonstrations and meetings held by Dr. King's Southern Christian Leadership Conference. King's people acknowledged that they needed a victory if there were not to be defections from their forces. That victory finally came when Dr. King threatened to march on the suburban town of Cicero. Chicago's civic leaders feared violence there, so at a hastily assembled summit meeting, they agreed to some concessions, and King called off his march. Through it all, though, he had insisted that no matter what the competition from his more militant black brothers, he would never renounce his policy of nonviolence.
Now what I'm saying is this. I would like for all of us to believe in nonviolence, but I'm here to say tonight that if every Negro in the United States turns against nonviolence, I'm going to stand up as a lone voice and say this is the wrong way.
I will never change in my basic idea that nonviolence is the most potent weapon available to the Negro in his struggle for freedom and justice. I think for the Negro to turn to violence would be both impractical and immoral.
There is an increasingly vocal minority who disagreed totally with your tactics, Dr. King.
There's no doubt about that. I would agree that there is a group in the Negro community advocating violence now. I happen to feel that this group represents a numerical minority. Surveys have revealed this. The vast majority of Negroes still feel that the best way to deal with the dilemma that we face in this country is through nonviolent resistance. And I don't think this vocal group will be able to make a real dent in the Negro community in terms of swaying 22 million Negroes to this particular point of view. And I contend that the cry of black power is at bottom a reaction to the reluctance of white power to make the kind of changes necessary to make justice a reality for the Negro. I think we've got to see that a riot is the language of the unheard. And what is it that America has failed to hear? It has failed to hear that the economic plight of the Negro poor has worsened over the last few years.
How many summers like this one do you imagine that we can expect?
Well, I would say this, we don't have long. The mood of the Negro community now is one of urgency, one of saying that we aren't going to wait, that we've got to have our freedom. We've waited too long. So that I would say that every summer we are going to have this kind of vigorous protest. My hope is that it will be nonviolent. I would hope that we can avoid riots because riots are self-defeating and socially destructive. I would hope that we can avoid riots, but that we will be as militant and as determined next summer and through the winter as we have been this summer. And I think the answer about how long it will take will depend on the federal government, on the city halls of our various cities, and on white America to a large extent. This is where we are at this point, and I think white America will determine how long it will be and which way we go in the future.
Even Senator Jacob Javits asked the question recently. He said that he was a slum resident, but he and some of his fellow Jews were able to make it out of the ghetto on the Lower East Side. The same thing is true with lots of Irish, Italians. And he asked the question why the Negro finds it so difficult to make his way up out of the ghetto.
Number one, no other racial group has been a slave on American soil. It's nice to say other people were down and they got up. They were not slaves on American soil. The other thing is that the Negro has had high visibility. And because of the prejudices existing in this country, his color has been against him. It's been against him, and they've used this to keep him from moving up. And the final analysis, when you say to a man that you are in this position because of your race or because of your color, you say to that man that he can never get out of it. Other racial groups have been able maybe to change the accent or change the names, but the Negro can't.
Martin Luther King is going through an agonizing reappraisal. He doesn't belong to the decadent aristocratic colonials of the civil rights movement.
Who are the decadent aristocratic?
Well, I don't want to call names, but the names are obvious. Martin Luther King has done a yeoman job, and he's got the guts to keep on doing it. And once he knows what black power really means, he doesn't know what it means.
What does it mean?
It means dignity. It doesn't mean violence. It means integrity. It doesn't mean anti-white. It means pride in being black. It means you're willing to cooperate with your white brother and sister if they're going to cooperate with you in terms of giving you the same things that they have. That's what it means.
But you suggest that he might be going through an agonizing reappraisal that will wind him up where?
Third phase of black revolution.
And does that mean casting aside his principles of nonviolence?
Mm-hmm. None of us have cast them aside. I don't think Stokely has either. This means that we have cast aside that we're not going to let nonviolence go all the way. That when nonviolence comes to the point of violence, we're going to meet violence with violence for our manhood.
When Stokely...
Not because we're black power, but for our manhood, that's all.
That search for what they call manhood is among the Negro male's most urgent motivations. It is especially so with the young militants. They call it their search for identity, for dignity, in a world in which they have too long been dictated to by whites.
A Negro architect helped design this building, the International Arrivals Building at Kennedy Airport. Daniel Watts, a graduate of Columbia University, was making $15,000 a year working for the white architectural firm of Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill when he quit 6 years ago. He quit, he says, to seek his own black manhood as publisher and editor of a black revolutionary magazine he calls The Liberator. It is a sounding board for the angriest anti-white writers in the black community. I asked Dan Watts about the thinly veiled threat of violence in all his writings.
I don't think there's a thin veiled threat of violence. I feel that at this juncture, because over a period of 100 years, the white establishment has built a barrier between the white power structure and the black community. This barrier being a wall consisting of neurotic white liberals and their house niggers that they draw from the community with their various lame-brain schemes to integrate us. The first thing that we have to do is knock this wall down forcibly in order to confront the white power structure with our demands.
Who are the house niggers you're talking about?
Roy Wilkins, your Martin Luther Kings, your Whitney Youngs. They do not represent the aspiration of the brother who is standing out there on 121st Street and Lenox Avenue now, who doesn't even have two coins to rub together. I suggest that my good white, so-called good white friends should take the civil rights that they want to give me. They should keep it and give me money and power instead.
Keep civil rights?
Let them keep it for themselves. Since it's such a wonderful commodity, I think the white should keep it and just give the black people the money and the power.
Give you money and power in what form?
All right, the money and power in what form? Instead of the dole, the handout, welfare, the federal government should look upon the black ghettos, the black communities, as a kind of, and you've heard this before, an undeveloped state. Except this is a hostile state. Black people constituting at best 11% of the population physically are incapable and militarily are incapable of overthrowing the United States. But we are capable of disrupting the economy of the United States. Now, when the power structure gets this into their head and begin to look upon us as a hostile force within their midst, then they will begin to deal with us on some meaningful plane.
And your policy is hot summers?
Hot summers, finally forcing a direct confrontation with the white power structure where we say, this is what we want. What are you prepared to negotiate now? We don't want brotherhood. You keep the brotherhood.
In other words, you think that the white community eventually will try to buy peace from the Negro?
They'll either do two things. Either they will try to buy this peace in terms of meaningful negotiations, or they will march us off to concentration camps led by Louis Armstrong playing We Shall Overcome and blessed by Martin Luther King as we go through the gates. See, white America still doesn't believe that black people are serious. King is just a new form of entertainment. Perhaps he doesn't shuffle his shoes the way Stephen Fetchett did, but he's still entertainment for you.
Is it a fact, Mr. Watts, that in a score of major American cities, there is a hard core of Negro extremists ready to fight?
I think you know that probably better than I do. I do not have access to the FBI file, but you call them extremists. I rather call them freedom fighters.
You think they're ready?
Oh, yes, there's no question about it. I think that what happened in Watts is just a prologue. Because whites still don't believe. They still don't believe that black people mean it when they say that we want power, we want black power. They don't believe it. They still think there was somebody other. It's very curious. See, very curious about the white mentality. You tell a white man you love him, he believes it. But you tell a white man, you know, I'm getting ready to slit your throat, he just can't believe it. It's inconceivable to his psyche to believe that a black man would want to cut his throat. Now, this is part of the white's hang-up.
You know, of course, that the heavy weight of power is on the side of the law. If it comes to a confrontation, an armed confrontation,
right,
between you and what you call the white power structure,
yeah,
you people are going to lose your lives, you're going to lose what property you've put together, and you're going to lose your opportunity.
Yes, but you see, Mike, we are dying today. The black boy, the black man that is shot in the back by a white policeman while he's handcuffed on the way into the station for allegedly trying to escape, that is dying. The child who is dying of malnutrition because of the oppressive economic system where the parents can't find work, that's death. So what I am suggesting that if we must die, let it be a meaningful death. If my mother and father were prepared to die the way my generation is, I think we would have been much closer toward a solution to the American dilemma of racism.
Daniel Moynihan was Assistant Secretary of Labor in both the Kennedy and Johnson administrations. He is the author of the controversial report on the Negro family, unofficially called the Moynihan Report. Long a student of Negro-white tensions in the United States, he is today director of the Joint Center for Urban Studies at MIT and Harvard. I asked Moynihan about the impact of a Dan Watts and a Stokely Carmichael.
Well, I would hope we would think there's something to hope for from a Stokely Carmichael and a Dan Watts. Now, they use a vocabulary that's pretty discouraging and pretty disrupting. People get excited, whites get upset. Well, they want you to get upset. And whoever met a 26-year-old social reformer didn't want you to get upset with what he had to say to you. But the things that Dan Watts asks for are not things that a person shouldn't be asking for. They aren't things he isn't entitled to. I mean, a man like Dan Watts is a skilled, trained architect, a university man, an American citizen. All he's saying is, give me and give us what is by rights the situation of any American, or if you don't, you're going to have trouble. But we don't need the trouble. We can give him what he's asking.
The trouble he threatens, of course, is violence. He says that he will disrupt American society if it means blowing manhole covers or possibly derailing trains or sniping or whatever. until the white man comes to the bargaining table and negotiates, buys peace from the black man.
All Dan Watts has said is that what's already going on is going to continue to go on, and I don't know why he isn't right. I think that he is likely to be right and likely know more about it than I do, for heaven's sakes. Where I think perhaps he is asking for things he can't quite get is in his own feeling of there are those whites out there and they will come to bargain with us, the Negroes. Unfortunately or fortunately, life is not that simple. There's no such thing as the Negro or Negro opinion or Negro power any more than there is white or white power. There's just a great mixture, a great confusion, a large system. And it never comes down to neat conclusions of that kind. We will come to the bargaining table and bargain. But there isn't any doubt about one thing, which is that violence terrifies organized communities, middle-class communities. And another fact, and a sad fact of life, is that violence works sometimes.
Who is closer to the dissatisfied Negro in the North? Stokely Carmichael, Dan Watts, Martin Luther King?
Martin Luther King, surely. He's much more national figure, but also he's much more in keeping with the political and moral traditions of the Negro American. Negro American is Southern in many of his antecedents, conservative in most of his politics, conservative in his religion, radical on only one point in American life, and that is the point of equality of the races, and if he's not radical about that, who's going to be?
Thus, an assessment of Negro leaders, Negro attitudes. We'll hear a variety of white reaction in a moment.
Volkswagen doesn't usually go in for this kind of stuff. But with all the noise about all the incomparable new car models at this time of year, it's a little hard to get heard with a quiet Volkswagen commercial. So we don't mind showing you a few pretty girls, because we don't have much else to show. Everybody knows by now what a Volkswagen looks like. As long as you pay attention to what we do have. Improvements. 33 improvements in the new Bug, including dual brakes, backup lights, seat belts, safety door locks, recessed door handles, and we made the Bug's engine bigger so it would accelerate faster and take hills better. Want to take a look at these new improvements all together? You can see them all in one familiar piece at your Volkswagen dealers.
CBS Reports continues. Black power, white backlash. Here is CBS News correspondent Mike Wallace.
If there was a symbol of white anger at Negro protest in the North this summer, it was Cicero, Illinois, a town chosen by Dr. Martin Luther King as the pressure point in his open housing drive. Cicero is a town with an inferiority complex. It winces at public attention because back in Prohibition days, it was notorious as the home of Al Capone, of bootlegging, B-girls, gambling. Today, it just wants to be left alone. But Dr. King had other ideas.
I think Cicero in the North symbolizes the same kind of hardcore resistance to change as Selma in the South. And I think it will, in fact, eventually be the Selma of the North in the sense that we've got to have a confrontation in that community.
Cicero is no stranger to racial violence. 15 years ago, a Negro family tried to move into this apartment dwelling there. An angry mob tossed the family's furniture out a third-floor window and made a bonfire that blazed 10 feet high. The National Guard had to be called in to restore order. No Negro family has tried to move in since. But late in the summer, Negroes marched on Cicero, led by militant organizations. And once again, the National Guard had to be called out to prevent bloodshed. The reaction of some of the residents of Cicero and many whites from surrounding areas was predictable. Bricks and bottles, taunts and catcalls were aimed at the marchers. The hostility was mutual, bitter, and undisguised. The question was, why? Why Cicero?
And is this the kind of reaction we can expect all across the North as Negroes press to live in white communities? Cicero is a town of first and second generation Americans, mostly Czechs, Poles, Lithuanians, Italians. Plus a late sprinkling of whites up from the United States South, mostly blue-collar workers, hard-working, law-abiding, overwhelmingly Republican, overwhelmingly for Goldwater in the last election. Homes are built one hard upon the other, scarcely a step apart. There is little vacant land in Cicero, virtually no slum, and there is fierce pride in property.
The average person out here, he's not a bank president, he's not a wealthy industrialist. He's a $80, $90, $100 a week man. Maybe now, if times are good, he's making $120. The biggest investment he'll ever make in his life is that house. That house to him means it's everything in the world for him. And when someone is going to bring down the value of that home or destroy it, or his neighbor is going to live in such a way that it may affect his property, that hits him right in the heart and in the pocketbook both, and he'll fight for it.
I walk down 25th Place, an attractive, if modest, residential street picked at random. Houses worth $15,000 to $25,000. Why, I wondered, is it so important to keep Negroes from living here? As you listen to the answers, ask yourself how different is the reaction in your own community.
Well, I'll tell you, property depreciates, and that Negroes move into a certain neighborhood. They'll buy one building, and there'll be a dozen families move into that building. Then you got a mess.
Of course, these are just one-story, one-family buildings here. Most of them, some of them, two families. So they...
Well, if they bought this building here, it's a six-room apartment, they might have two families living in there. And they might put another family down in the basement, maybe two families down in the basement. There you're taking of a mess there again.
So it's just because you think they might be messy neighbors. That's the only reason.
Well, that's the only reason. If there was one family in one building and they took care of their place, I don't see why people wouldn't tolerate them.
How would you feel about Negroes moving in here to Cicero?
Well, I really don't know, but some Negroes are clean and some aren't. And if they move in on this block and they're clean, I would play with them.
Mm-hmm. What does your mom and dad say about it?
Well, they say, well, I really don't know. They don't say too much about it.
Are they enthusiastic or no?
No.
No.
My dad says if they do, well, we're just going to have to move, maybe.
Is that your mother up there working?
Yes, it is.
Let's see if I can't talk to her for just a moment. Ma'am, I wonder if I could ask you to come on down the stairs just an instant and talk to me. There's been so much talk recently about Cicero and Negroes and property values. What's your view?
Well, I'm perfectly satisfied with the neighbors we have. We have old homes here. We take very good care of them.
I see that you do.
And when it would come right down to it, I don't think we would object to other neighbors if they would come up to our standards of living.
Well, do you think that the fact that a man is a Negro or a woman is a Negro, on the face of it, simply makes them an undesirable neighbor?
No, not really. I've known so many colored people that are so nice. But like I say, I think they have to learn to live the way we do and take care of things.
How do people learn to live that way?
By hard work. We have worked very, very hard for what we have. We've been here 30 years and we didn't get anything for nothing. We worked very hard for what we have and we're still working hard to maintain it.
How would you feel, truly, if a colored family were to move in over there with the washers hanging on the line?
Oh, I don't know. I really couldn't say. I'd probably get along very good with them. If they leave me alone, I leave them alone.
Uh-huh.
I'd probably be afraid to go out at night.
Afraid to go out at night?
kind of colored people living around here.
You mean you think there are violent people?
Well, some of them are. There are some that really would be like that, and there are some good ones, too. Mm-hmm. So you really couldn't trust any of them.
There are many good coloreds, and I worked with some of them, and I liked them, and I liked this person that I said works at the lounge over there. But there's the ones that are going to march I don't like, and I can't stand, I got no use for.
And when your church tells you human rights, and you pay no attention to your church?
I pay attention to my church when they say about human rights. But what the marchers want, they don't want rights. They say they want peaceful coexistence. How can they have peaceful coexistence when there's all this trouble?
Who makes the trouble?
They do, by marching. There's got to be a simpler way.
What simpler way can you think of?
Talks. Just talks.
Well, there are human rights commissions in various towns around Chicago, none in Cicero.
They can make them.
You think they should?
They should. I just think that there has got to be a better way than marches. Because there's no use for them.
If, let's say, 10 or 20 families moved into Cicero, which is a town of 70,000.
They'd get killed.
Cicero is an industrial town. It doesn't mind that Negroes work in the factories there. 15,000 of them do. And they trade at Cicero banks and supermarkets. But not a single Negro family sleeps in Cicero. Not one spends the night. I asked some workers why.
Because they don't know the Negro, that's why.
How do you mean?
Well, they think their value of their property goes down, and the majority of them feel like we're dirty, and they are afraid, that's all.
And they talk about violence, too. What about some of those criticisms, that the Negro is dirty, that the Negro is more violent, therefore the Negro doesn't make as good a neighbor?
Well, that's because they have never given the Negro the chance. They don't know it, the Negro, I told them. If they would stay long enough, the Negro is not dirty. It's some of them, I guess, it's just like some of the whites are dirty.
Well, I don't think they could even afford to live in our area, most of them, what I see marching.
What about the people who live right, who work right here at Western Electric?
Well, there's a lot of good ones here that work here, but still, we don't want to mix with them to live with them.
Why? You'll work with them?
But I don't want to live with them.
Why?
Because I moved out of a neighborhood that was colored. I had to move. Everybody that lives with the colored has to move.
Why?
Because you're not safe walking the streets at night. You cannot leave the house.
That's an illiterate statement, judging people by the colors of their skin. I think the only way that you can judge a person is according to their behavior pattern.
Do you demonstrate? Do you work for Dr. King or the West Side Organization or CORE?
No, I haven't had any association or any affiliation with Dr. King, but simply because I don't see where he's accomplishing anything. I mean, sure, marching, everybody know what the situation is, but what is it accomplishing? I noticed the papers the other day, he and Mayor Daley appeared, and Mayor Daley had a big smile on his face. You know, everything is solved. What's solved? What about the schooling situation? What about better living conditions? What about people's rights and justice and equality? What about those things? Nothing is solved. The situation is still the same. The man with the money, the man with the money rules.
And who's the man with the money?
The white man. Who else?
The white man. Who else? The gun issue this summer in Cicero and elsewhere has been open housing. Some white men who control their own small pieces of real estate got together to resist Negro demands.
Do you think we're on the right track?
Right!
Will you help?
Yeah!
Walter Douglas is executive vice president of groups representing two white neighborhoods that border on a Negro slum.
The main problem is that once a Negro moves into a community, this one as any other community, once he is there, no white person will buy in that community because it is known then or labeled as a changing neighborhood. So the only available prospects will be Negro buyers. Obviously, the neighborhood is not going to integrate, it's going to inundate, and it's going to become an all-Negro neighborhood. The question is getting white people to move in to a neighborhood once a Negro has bought a home there. The Ryzen Index and the National Gross Product and so forth, these people really don't understand that much. But they do understand that $14,000 home that it's taken them all their lives to pay for, and now they're living in a community with all the facilities paid for, the church nearby, a good store, a good neighbor, and so forth, that they're going to be forced out of it. Next year, there will be riots, there will be bloodshed, because this year it was chopped off after the people had armed themselves. Our gun shops in the southern suburbs sold out of ammunition and guns. These people are armed. One man was bragging to me that he has 25 pounds of dynamite in his garage. He's going to stop them this way. This is what they are. They are armed. They are ready now. They were not this summer. Next summer it will not be rocks and bricks and bottles, but actual armed rebellion against the civil rights marchers coming into the area. And people are going to be hurt. Good people, bad people, all kinds of people.
We'll hear other views from other white men, long-range views on black and white, in just a moment.
America is involved in a different kind of a war in Vietnam, a war requiring a different kind of reporting. The thorough, thoughtful reporting the distinguished team of CBS News correspondents bring to their on-the-spot coverage.
Vietnam.
Reports from such men as Eric Severide.
But this is more than just a...
Charles Collingwood.
This happens about once every month to 6 weeks.
Maury Safer.
Join the Navy and see...
Peter Kalischer.
300 yards of front line near the...
Charles Curault. Their reports flow into the CBS newsroom in New York, where managing editor Walter Cronkite, who has also reported directly from the battlefront, prepares them for broadcast. CBS News cannot give you the answers to this often confusing situation, but you'll have all the facts that are available. Keep abreast of what is happening in Vietnam and around the world. Watch the CBS Evening News with Walter Cronkite. CBS Reports continues. Black power, white backlash.
Mr. Moynihan, the hate and the anger and fear felt by the white majority for the Negro minority, is it different from the reaction to the wave of Irish and Italian and Jewish immigrants who came to the United States in the late 19th, early 20th century?
There are many points of similarity. I think if we remembered our history better, we would know that the reaction of the Protestant Yankee to the Catholic Irish when he arrived was very similar to that of whites reacting to Negroes now. The big fact, though, and the one that's hard to overcome, is of color. I mean, you can always somehow think you can see a Negro, but I'd like to suggest that that's not necessarily so either. Because 25 years ago in this country, if you remember, Japanese were yellow, Chinese were yellow, and the federal government discriminated against American-born Japanese as it has never discriminated against any group in our history. Yet in the intervening quarter century, the Japanese, Chinese in America have become our most educated, our most entrepreneurial, our, in terms of census data, as we say, our highest social economic group in this nation. And where'd the yellow go? They cease to be colored.
Hasn't the white community in the United States changed its attitude toward the Negro of Harlem, wherever Harlem is, in the last year?
Yes, I think it has. There is a withdrawal of sentiment that cannot be mistaken. And I think in all candor, we have to admit to ourselves that some of the violence in the cities this summer have made it appear to many that the Negroes were aggressors. And whether they had any reason for being aggressors is another question entirely. People don't think very far beyond that point. So that the sympathy for the oppressed is not there to begin with. And you have to start dealing with much more complicated problems.
How serious do you imagine the white backlash will be this November in votes?
Well, the backlash, if that's the word, has already been felt. We lost the Civil Rights Act. We did not get the president's bill. The most powerful Democratic liberal voting majority in the history of the century, probably, in Congress, didn't do what it ought to have done. And the reason it did not has been fairly clear, the withdrawal of sympathy around the country.
In view of what seems to be the climate in the white community, is it possible that we simply won't make racial progress without racial violence?
You could write a scenario, as the strategists say, by which the whites withdrew, by which problems got worse, for which Negro frustrations grew, which led to the whites withdrawing more, and are escalating ourselves into a genuine racial confrontation in this country. You could do that. It's happened before in the world. I don't think it will happen here, because in the end it's in no one's interest for it to happen.
Lewis Harris is one of this nation's foremost public opinion analysts in years gone by and again this summer. His poll takers have tested public sentiment for Newsweek magazine on all the issues involving the black man and the white man, North and South. Mr. Harris, how much of a change has there been in the northern white man's attitudes toward the black man during the summer of 1966?
Mike, there have been dramatic shifts that have taken place over this summer. For example, you find that compared with 2 years ago, when you had white people split 50-50 over whether Negroes were trying to move too fast, now you find almost 3-1 white people think the pace of civil rights progress is too fast in this country.
Well, what is at the root of the white man's change of attitude?
I think perhaps most dramatic is in the area of demonstrations, where you found back in 1963, on the eve of the March on Washington, a majority of white people felt that such demonstrations could help the cause of Negroes achieving civil rights in this country. Before this summer began, you found it was about 2-1 white people feeling that demonstrations were hurting the Negro cause. At the end of this summer, now we find in this month of September, we find 81-19, 4-1, white people think the demonstrations of the civil rights movement hurt the Negro cause.
Negro violence, I suppose, has a good deal of what is imagined, understood to be Negro violence.
Well, the demonstrations, I think, would not have had this impact if it hadn't been for the fear that whites have over the violence of riots that have taken place in Negro ghettos in northern cities and, in fact, in Atlanta and some southern cities. As a consequence, back in 1963, you found that better than 7 out of 10 whites thought that Negroes were committed to nonviolence. Today, this is very nearly an even division, with just over a majority feeling Negroes aren't violent. And when you break this down by low-income people, you find that hardly more than a third of the low-income white people in this country are convinced that Negroes are not violent.
Which Negro demands breed the most hostility, Mr. Harris?
Well, you find, Mike, that education, whites bristle some at that, some on jobs, a little more on welfare, but most of all, where the shoe really binds and where the pinch is felt is on housing. The fear that whites have over Negroes moving into their neighborhoods is without question the deepest fear that abounds in white society today.
Does the Negro himself feel strongly about open housing?
Well, the Negro does. Yes, Negroes are committed 78-22 to integrated housing. Make no mistake about that. They are four square for that. And this stands in complete juxtaposition and comparison with the low-income whites, who are just as fiercely, 70-30, opposed to integrated housing. So right at the level where it'll happen, in the neighborhoods, you get this clash.
What about the so-called white liberal at the end of this summer?
Well, there's been a dramatic shift here. Back in 1963, 2 out of every 3 white, college-educated liberal people, mainly in the North, were in sympathy to the civil rights movement. On the eve of this summer, in May of this year, you found just about 50% of these white liberals who were sympathetic, a slippage. But at the end of this summer, it's scarcely more than 1 in 4 who feel sympathetic any longer. There's been a disenchantment among your white liberals with the civil rights movement.
Do Negroes themselves support the tactics of their various leaders? And I wish that you differentiate between Carmichael and King.
Well, Mike, I think it should be pointed out that Negroes support militant policies on the part of their leaders, but they make a very sharp distinction between the militancy with overtones of violence as represented by Stokely Carmichael and militancy with dedication and commitment to nonviolence, which seems to be the policy of Martin Luther King. And it's no happenstance that King is literally the leader of the movement, while Carmichael is neither well-known nor well-supported.
Finally, Mr. Harris, what about the backlash in the November elections?
Mike, it could be decisive in this election. It could be decisive because it can tear the Democratic Party apart at the seams in the North, where you, traditionally low-income whites and low-income Negroes must be on the same side. Today, they're not on the same side over civil rights. This could cost the Democrats and cost them heavily. In fact, it could have an effect in 20 out of the 45 freshman Congress seats. The white backlash issue could be the decisive issue November 8th.
Thank you, Lewis Harris. There can be no doubt that at the end of summer 1966, the white man and the black man in the North eye each other with more suspicion and hostility than they ever have before, as Lewis Harris points out. Even the white liberal confesses his impatience, his disenchantment. And the black moderate has begun to wonder how long he'll be able to restrain his more militant brothers, or perhaps whether he must join them. And who can say that the next summer will not be more violent than the last? The thought of open racial warfare in the United States is so far-fetched, so repugnant, as to be ludicrous to most of us. But the bitter question is how to repair the dangerous and widening breach between black and white American. Edmund Burke has said, the only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men to do nothing. If the methods of the extremists, black and white, are not eventually to prevail, then the rest of the community, black and white, the vast majority, must come together now to solve this American dilemma. Mike Wallace, good evening.
CBS reports.
I don't know why he isn't right. I think that he is likely to be right and likely know more about it than I do, for heaven's sakes. Where I think perhaps he is asking for things he can't quite get is in his own feeling of there are those whites out there and they will come to bargain with us, the Negroes. Unfortunately or fortunately, life is not that simple. There's no such thing as the Negro or Negro opinion or Negro power any more than there is white or white power. There's just a great mixture, a great confusion, a large system. And it never comes down to neat conclusions of that kind. We will come to the bargaining table and bargain. But there isn't any doubt about one thing, which is that violence terrifies organized communities, middle-class communities. And another fact, and a sad fact of life, is that violence works sometimes.
Who is closer to the dissatisfied Negro in the North? Stokely Carmichael, Dan Watts, Martin Luther King?
Martin Luther King, surely. He's a much more national figure, but also he's much more in keeping with the political and moral traditions of the Negro American. Negro American is Southern in many of his antecedents, conservative in most of his politics, conservative in his religion, radical on only one point in American life, and that is the point of equality of the races, and if he's not radical about that, who's going to be?
Thus, an assessment of Negro leaders, Negro attitudes. We'll hear a variety of white reaction in a moment.
Volkswagen doesn't usually go in for this kind of stuff. But with all the noise about all the incomparable new car models at this time of year, it's a little hard to get heard with a quiet Volkswagen commercial. So we don't mind showing you a few pretty girls, because we don't have much else to show. Everybody knows by now what a Volkswagen looks like. As long as you pay attention to what we do have. Improvements. 33 improvements in the new Bug, including dual brakes, backup lights, seat belts, safety door locks, recessed door handles, and we made the Bug's engine bigger so it would accelerate faster and take hills better. Want to take a look at these new improvements all together? You can see them all in one familiar piece at your Volkswagen dealers.
CBS Reports continues. Black power, white backlash. Here is CBS News correspondent Mike Wallace.
If there was a symbol of white anger at Negro protest in the North this summer, it was Cicero, Illinois,
a town chosen by Dr. Martin Luther King as the pressure point in his open housing drive. Cicero is a town with an inferiority complex. It winces at public attention because back in Prohibition days, it was notorious as the home of Al Capone, of bootlegging, B-girls, gambling. Today, it just wants to be left alone. But Dr. King had other ideas.
I think Cicero in the North symbolizes the same kind of hardcore resistance to change as Selma in the South. And I think it will, in fact, eventually be the Selma of the North in the sense that we've got to have a confrontation in that community.
Cicero is no stranger to racial violence. 15 years ago, a Negro family tried to move into this apartment dwelling there. An angry mob tossed the family's furniture out a third-floor window and made a bonfire that blazed 10 feet high. The National Guard had to be called in to restore order. No Negro family has tried to move in since. But late in the summer, Negroes marched on Cicero, led by militant organizations. And once again, the National Guard had to be called out to prevent bloodshed. The reaction of some of the residents of Cicero and many whites from surrounding areas was predictable. Bricks and bottles, taunts and catcalls were aimed at the marchers. The hostility was mutual, bitter, and undisguised. The question was, why? Why Cicero? And is this the kind of reaction we can expect all across the North as Negroes press to live in white communities? Cicero is a town of first and second generation Americans, mostly Czechs, Poles, Lithuanians, Italians, plus a late sprinkling of whites up from the United States South. Mostly blue-collar workers, hard-working, law-abiding, overwhelmingly Republican, overwhelmingly for Goldwater in the last election. Homes are built one hard upon the other, scarcely a step apart. There is little vacant land in Cicero, virtually no slum, and there is fierce pride in property.
The average person out here, he's not a bank president, he's not a wealthy industrialist. He's a $80, $90, $100 a week man. Maybe now, if times are good, he's making $120. The biggest investment he'll ever make in his life is that house. That house to him means it's everything in the world for him. And when someone is going to bring down the value of that home or destroy it, or his neighbor is going to live in such a way that it may affect his property, that hits him right in the heart and in the pocketbook both, and he'll fight for it.
I walked down 25th Place, an attractive, if modest, residential street picked at random. Houses worth $15,000 to $25,000. Why, I wondered, is it so important to keep Negroes from living here? As you listen to the answers, ask yourself how different is the reaction in your own community.
Well, I'll tell you, property depreciates, and as Negroes move into a certain neighborhood, they'll buy one building, and there'll be a dozen families move into that building. Then you got a mess.
Of course, these are just one-story, one-family buildings here, most of them, some of them two families. So
well, if they bought this building here, it's a six-room apartment, they might have two families living in there. And they might put another family down in the basement, maybe two families down in the basement. There you're taking have a mess there again.
So it's just because you think they might be messy neighbors. That's the only reason.
Well, that's the only reason. If there was one family in one building and they took care of their place, I don't see why people wouldn't tolerate them.
How would you feel about Negroes moving in here to Cicero?
Well, I really don't know, but some Negroes are clean and some aren't. And if they move in on this block and they're clean, I would play with them.
Mm-hmm. What does your mom and dad say about it?
Well, they say, well, I really don't know. They don't say too much about it.
Are they enthusiastic or no?
No.
No.
my dad says if they do, well, we're just going to have to move, maybe.
Is that your mother up there working?
Yes, it is.
Let's see if I can't talk to her for just a moment. Ma'am, I wonder if I could ask you to come on down the stairs just an instant and talk to me. There's been so much talk recently about Cicero and Negroes and property values. What's your view?
Well, I'm perfectly satisfied with the neighbors we have. We have old homes here. We take very good care of them.
I see that you do.
And when it would come right down to it, I don't think we would object to other neighbors if they would come up to our standards of living.
Well, do you think that the fact that a man is a Negro or a woman is a Negro, on the face of it, simply makes them an undesirable neighbor?
No, not really. I've known so many colored people that are so nice. But like I say, I think they have to learn to live the way we do and take care of things.
How do people learn to live that way?
By hard work. We have worked very, very hard for what we have. We've been here 30 years and we didn't get anything for nothing. We worked very hard for what we have and we're still working hard to maintain it.
How would you feel, truly, if a colored family were to move in over there with the washers hanging on the line?
Oh, I don't know. I really couldn't say. I'd probably get along very good with them. If they leave me alone, I leave them alone.
Uh-huh.
But probably I'd be afraid to go out at night.
Afraid to go out at night?
What kind of colored people living around here?
You mean you think there are violent people?
Well, some of them are. There are some that really would be like that, and there are some good ones, too.
Mm-hmm.
You really couldn't trust any of them.
There are many good coloreds, and I worked with some of them, and I liked them, and I liked this person that I said works at the lounge over there. But there's the ones that are going to march I don't like, and I can't stand, I got no use for.
And when your church tells you human rights, and you pay no attention to your church?
I pay attention to my church when they say about human rights, but what the marchers want, they don't want rights. They say they want peaceful coexistence. How can they have peaceful coexistence when there's all this trouble?
Who makes the trouble?
They do, by marching. There's got to be a simpler way.
What simpler way can you think of?
Talks. Just talks.
Well, there are human rights commissions in various towns around Chicago, none in Cicero.
They can make them.
You think they should?
They should. I just think that there has got to be a better way than marches. Because there's no use for them.
If, let's say, 10 or 20 families moved into Cicero, which is a town of 70,000.
They'd get killed.
Cicero is an industrial town. It doesn't mind that Negroes work in the factories there. 15,000 of them do. And they trade at Cicero banks and supermarkets. But not a single Negro family sleeps in Cicero. Not one spends the night. I asked some workers why.
Because they don't know the Negro, that's why.
How do you mean?
Well, they think their value of their property goes down. And the majority of them feel that we're dirty. And they are afraid, that's all.
And they talk about violence, too. What about some of those criticisms, that the Negro is dirty, that the Negro is more violent, therefore the Negro doesn't make as good a neighbor?
Well, that's because they have never given the Negro the chance. They don't know it, the Negro, I told. If they would stay long enough, the Negro is not dirty. It's some of them, I guess, it's just like some of the whites are dirty.
Well, I don't think they could even afford to live in our area, most of them, what I see marching.
What about the people who live right, who work right here at Western Electric?
Well, there's a lot of good ones here that work here, but still, we don't want to mix with them to live with them.
Why? You'll work with them?
But I don't want to live with them.
Why?
Because I moved out of a neighborhood that was colored. I had to move. Everybody that lives with the colored has to move.
Why?
Because you're not safe walking the streets at night. You cannot leave the house.
That's an illiterate statement, judging people by the colors of their skin. I think the only way that you can judge a person is according to their behavior pattern.
Do you demonstrate? Do you work for Dr. King or the West Side Organization or CORE?
No, I haven't had any association or any affiliation with Dr. King, but simply because I don't see where he's accomplishing anything. I mean, sure, marching, everybody know what the situation is, but what is it accomplishing? I noticed the papers the other day,
He and Mayor Daley appeared, and Mayor Daley had a big smile on his face. You know, everything is solid. What's solid? What about the schooling situation? What about better living conditions? What about people's rights and justice and equality? What about those things? Nothing is solid. The situation is still the same. The man with the money, the man with the money rules.
And who's the man with the money?
The white man. Who else?
The white man. Who else? The gun issue this summer in Cicero and elsewhere has been open housing. Some white men who control their own small pieces of real estate got together to resist Negro demands.
Do you think we're on the right track?
Right!
Will you help?
Walter Douglas is executive vice president of groups representing two white neighborhoods that border on a Negro slum.
The main problem is that once a Negro moves into a community, this one as any other community, once he is there, no white person will buy in that community because it is known then or labeled as a changing neighborhood. So the only available prospects will be Negro buyers. Obviously, the neighborhood is not going to integrate, it's going to inundate, and it's going to become an all-Negro neighborhood. The question is getting white people to move in to a neighborhood once a Negro has bought a home there. The Rising Index and the National Gross Product and so forth, these people really don't understand that much. But they do understand that $14,000 home that it's taken them all their lives to pay for, and now they're living in a community with all the facilities paid for, the church nearby, a good store, a good neighbor, and so forth, that they're going to be forced out of it. Next year, there will be riots, there will be bloodshed, because this year it was chopped off after the people had armed themselves. Our gun shops in the southern suburbs sold out of ammunition and guns. These people are armed. One man was bragging to me that he has 25 pounds of dynamite in his garage. He's going to stop them this way. This is what they are. They are armed. They are ready now. They were not this summer. Next summer, it will not be rocks and bricks and bottles, but actual armed rebellion against the civil rights marchers coming into the area. And people are going to be hurt. Good people, bad people, all kinds of people.
We'll hear other views from other white men, long-range views on black and white, in just a moment.
America is involved in a different kind of a war in Vietnam, a war requiring a different kind of reporting. The thorough, thoughtful reporting the distinguished team of CBS News correspondents bring to their on-the-spot coverage.
Vietnam.
Reports from such men as Eric Severide.
But this is more than just a...
Charles Collingwood.
This happens about once every month to 6 weeks.
Maury Safer.
Join the Navy and see...
Peter Kalischer.
300 yards of front line near the...
Charles Curault. Their reports flow into the CBS newsroom in New York, where managing editor Walter Cronkite, who has also reported directly from the battlefront, prepares them for broadcast. CBS News cannot give you the answers to this often confusing situation, but you'll have all the facts that are available. Keep abreast of what is happening in Vietnam and around the world. Watch the CBS Evening News with Walter Cronkite. CBS Reports continues. Black power, white backlash.
Mr. Moynihan, the hate and the anger and fear felt by the white majority for the Negro minority, is it different from the reaction to the wave of Irish and Italian and Jewish immigrants who came to the United States in the late 19th, early 20th century?
There are many points of similarity. I think if we remembered our history better, we would know that the reaction of the Protestant Yankee to the Catholic Irish when he arrived was very similar to that of whites reacting to Negroes now. The big fact, though, and the one that's hard to overcome, is of color. I mean, you can always somehow think you can see a Negro, but I'd like to suggest that that's not necessarily so either, because 25 years ago in this country, if you remember, Japanese were yellow, Chinese were yellow, and the federal government discriminated against American-born Japanese as it has never discriminated against any group in our history. Yet in the intervening quarter century, the Japanese, Chinese in America have become our most educated, our most entrepreneurial, our, in terms of census data, as we say, our highest social economic group in this nation. And where'd the yellow go? They cease to be colored.
Hasn't the white community in the United States changed its attitude toward the Negro of Harlem, wherever Harlem is, in the last year?
Yes, I think it has. There is a withdrawal of sentiment that cannot be mistaken. And I think in all candor, we have to admit to ourselves that some of the violence in the cities this summer have made it appear to many that the Negroes were aggressors. And whether they had any reason for being aggressors is another question entirely. People don't think very far beyond that point. So that the sympathy for the oppressed is not there to begin with. And you have to start dealing with much more complicated problems.
How serious do you imagine the white backlash will be this November in votes?
Well, the backlash, if that's the word, has already been felt. We lost the Civil Rights Act. We did not get the president's bill. The most powerful Democratic liberal voting majority in the history of the century, probably, in Congress, didn't do what it ought to have done. And the reason it did not has been fairly clear, the withdrawal of sympathy around the country.
In view of what seems to be the climate in the white community, is it possible that we simply won't make racial progress without racial violence?
You could write a scenario, as the strategists say, by which the whites withdrew, by which problems got worse, for which Negro frustrations grew, which led to the whites withdrawing more, and are escalating ourselves into a genuine racial confrontation in this country. You could do that. It's happened before in the world. I don't think it will happen here, because in the end it's in no one's interest for it to happen.
Lewis Harris is one of this nation's foremost public opinion analysts. In years gone by and again this summer, his poll takers have tested public sentiment for Newsweek magazine resident, but he and some of his fellow Jews were able to make it out of the ghetto on the Lower East Side. The same thing is true with lots of Irish, Italians. And he asked the question why the Negro finds it so difficult to make his way up out of the ghetto.
Number one, no other racial group has been a slave on American soil. It's nice to say other people were down and they got up. They were not slaves on American soil. The other thing is that the Negro has had high visibility. And because of the prejudices existing in this country, his color has been against him. It's been against him. And they've used this to keep him from moving up. And the final analysis, when you say to a man that you are in this position because of your race or because of your color, you say to that man that he can never get out of it. Other racial groups have been able maybe to change the accent or change the names, but the Negro can't.
Martin Luther King is going through an agonizing reappraisal. He doesn't belong to the decadent aristocratic colonials of the civil rights movement.
Who are the decadent aristocratic?
Well, I don't want to call names, but the names are obvious. Martin Luther King has done a yeoman job, and he's got the guts to keep on doing it. And once he knows what black power really means, he doesn't know what it means.
What does it mean?
It means dignity. It doesn't mean violence. It means integrity. It doesn't mean anti-white. It means pride in being black. It means you're willing to cooperate with your white brother and sister if they're going to cooperate with you in terms of giving you the same things that they have. That's what it means.
But you suggest that he might be going through an agonizing reappraisal that will wind him up where?
Third phase of black revolution.
And does that mean casting aside his principles of nonviolence?
Mm-hmm. None of us have cast them aside. I don't think Stokely has either. This means that we have cast aside that we're not going to let nonviolence go all the way. That when nonviolence comes to the point of violence, we're going to meet violence with violence for our manhood.
When Stokely...
Not because we're black power, but for our manhood, that's all.
That search for what they call manhood is among the Negro male's most urgent motivations. It is especially so with the young militants. They call it their search for identity, for dignity.
in a world in which they have too long been dictated to by whites.
A Negro architect helped design this building, the International Arrivals Building at Kennedy Airport. Daniel Watts, a graduate of Columbia University, was making $15,000 a year working for the white architectural firm of Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill when he quit 6 years ago. He quit, he says, to seek his own black manhood as publisher and editor of a black revolutionary magazine he calls The Liberator. It is a sounding board for the angriest anti-white writers in the black community. I asked Dan Watts about the thinly veiled threat of violence in all his writings.
I don't think there's a thin veiled threat of violence. I feel that at this juncture, because over a period of 100 years, the white establishment has built a barrier between the white power structure and the black community. This barrier being a wall consisting of neurotic white liberals and their house niggers that they draw from the community with their various lame-brain schemes to integrate us. The first thing that we have to do is knock this wall down forcibly in order to confront the white power structure with our demands.
Who are the house niggers you're talking about?
Roy Wilkins, your Martin Luther Kings, your Whitney Youngs. They do not represent the aspiration of the brother who is standing out there on 121st Street and Lenox Avenue now, who doesn't even have two coins to rub together. I suggest that my good white, so-called good white friends should take this civil rights that they want to give me. They should keep it and give me money and power instead.
Keep civil rights?
They let them keep it for themselves. Since it's such a wonderful commodity, I think the whites should keep it and just give the black people the money and the power.
Give you money and power in what form?
All right, the money and power in what form? Instead of the dole, the handout, welfare, the federal government should look upon the black ghettos, the black communities, as a kind of, and you've heard this before, an undeveloped state. Except this is a hostile state. Black people constituting at best 11% of the population physically are incapable and militarily are incapable of overthrowing the United States. But we are capable of disrupting the economy of the United States. Now, when the power structure gets this into their head and begin to look upon us as a hostile force within their midst, then they will begin to deal with us on some meaningful plane.
And your policy is hot summers?
Hot summers, finally forcing a direct confrontation with the white power structure where we say, this is what we want. What are you prepared to negotiate now? We don't want brotherhood. You keep the brotherhood.
In other words, you think that the white community eventually will try to buy peace from the Negro?
They'll either do two things. Either they will try to buy this peace in terms of meaningful negotiations, or they will march us off to concentration camps led by Louis Armstrong playing We Shall Overcome and blessed by Martin Luther King as we go through the gates. See, white America still doesn't believe that black people are serious. King is just a new form of entertainment. Perhaps he doesn't shuffle his shoes the way Stephen Fetchett did, but he's still entertainment for you.
Is it a fact, Mr. Watts, that in a score of major American cities, there is a hard core of Negro extremists ready to fight?
I think you know that probably better than I do. I do not have access to the FBI file, but you call them extremists, I rather call them freedom fighters.
You think they're ready?
Oh, yes, there's no question about it. I think that what happened in Watts is just a prologue. Because whites still don't believe. They still don't believe that black people mean it when they say that we want power, we want black power. They don't believe it. They still think it was somebody other. It's very curious. See, very curious about the white mentality. You tell a white man you love him, he believes it. You tell a white man, you know, I'm getting ready to slit your throat, he just can't believe it. It's inconceivable to his psyche to believe that a black man would want to cut his throat. Now, this is part of the white's hang-up.
You know, of course, that the heavy weight of power is on the side of the law. If it comes to a confrontation, an armed confrontation,
right,
between you and what you call the white power structure,
yeah,
you people are going to lose your lives, you're going to lose what property you've put together, and you're going to lose your opportunity.
Yes, but you see, Mike, we are dying today. The black boy, the black man that is shot in the back by a white policeman while he's handcuffed on the way into the station for trying to allegedly trying to escape. That is dying. The child who is dying of malnutrition because of the oppressive economic system where the parents can't find work, that's death. So what I am suggesting that if we must die, let it be a meaningful death. If my mother and father were prepared to die the way my generation is, I think we would have been much closer toward a solution to the American dilemma of racism.
Daniel Moynihan was Assistant Secretary of Labor in both the Kennedy and Johnson administrations. He is the author of the controversial report on the Negro family, unofficially called the Moynihan Report. Long a student of Negro-white tensions in the United States, he is today director of the Joint Center for Urban Studies at MIT and Harvard. I asked Moynihan about the impact of a Dan Watts and a Stokely Carmichael.
Well, I would hope we would think there's something to hope for from a Stokely Carmichael and a Dan Watts. Now, they use a vocabulary that's pretty discouraging and pretty disrupting. People get excited, whites get upset. Well, they want you to get upset. And whoever met a 26-year-old social reformer didn't want you to get upset with what he had to say to you. But the things that Dan Watts asks for are not things that a person shouldn't be asking for. They aren't things he isn't entitled to. I mean, a man like Dan Watts is a skilled, trained architect, a university man, an American citizen. All he's saying is, give me and give us what is by rights the situation of any American, or if you don't, you're going to have trouble. But we don't need the trouble. We can give him what he's asking.
The trouble he threatens, of course, is violence. He says that he will disrupt American society if it means blowing manhole covers or possibly derailing trains or sniping or whatever until the white man comes to the bargaining table and negotiates, buys peace from the black man.
All Dan Watts has said is that what's already going on is going to continue to go on.
In our neighborhoods so that we're not exploited, so that we're not charged high rents to share apartments with rats, and so that the owners of those apartments don't live in the suburbs grabbing the profits from us, that we're able to grab it, and that the money will be able to stay in our community so we can develop it. It is no different from a colony in Africa who is supposedly free, but her resources are controlled by the mother country. They have to move to a position to control the resources, and having done that, their problems are already solved.
And the means that you will use to achieve all of this?
What? Any means necessary.
Well, I know, but now, well, spell that out. What does that mean?
It means that we will develop tactics as we go along, and whatever those tactics are, we will use them.
Tactics? That means you've got to buy the buildings. You've got to start the businesses. You've got to train the people. How are you going to do that by yourselves? How are you going to do it without the help of the white community?
Well, the first help we'd need of the white community is just to turn over those buildings to us.
Turn them over?
That's correct. Turn them over.
You think that's likely, Mr. Carmichael?
Well, you asked me what help we wanted white people to give. Or they could buy it for us.
You mean Washington would buy it from, let's say, the slumlord and turn it over to you?
That's correct.
You believe, really, that that is the salvation of the black man?
I think that this country is run by property ownership, and that black people are not only propertyless, they are viewed as property. And we have to move to a position of property ownership in this country so that we can bargain from a position of strength with racists rather than a position of weakness.
You're one black man who went to a good, essentially white high school in the city of New York.
That's
you
correct.
Obviously had a good education.
That's
a good many of the people who work with you here in SNCC can say the same thing.
And we're saying that...
And you're a black man who came from a New York ghetto.
And we're saying that there's a system that allows for one or two black people to get out, and that that's the rationale for keeping other black people down.
And it has nothing to do with the unwillingness or inability of the Negro to help himself and to work hard.
That's the rationale, that the reason why black people aren't this is because they're lazy, unambitious, stupid, have rhythm, and they eat watermelon.
You call on the black man to refuse to respond to his draft call.
That is correct. And we will continue to do so while there's breath in our bodies.
Do you really believe that the military policies of the United States are designed to exterminate the black man, as you've said?
I most certainly do. I look at the recent statement by racist McNamara, who says that 30% of the people that are going to be drafted now under his new system are going to be black people, and that's nothing more than black urban removal.
The white liberal, who supported civil rights for so long with time and effort and money, what is your feeling about him?
Well, I think that there's no reason why they should stop supporting the movement now. I certainly feel that if they're genuinely interested in black people, and since black people have charted a course, they believe in that program, they will continue to give to it. They need more white people to civilize whites. They need them to civilize the savages in Cicero, who throw rocks and bricks at a peaceful and lovable black man like Dr. Martin Luther King, who would not even hurt a fly. And that's very important, because our uncles and our fathers and our older brothers died in World War I fighting Nazism to protect the Poles, and those same Poles turn around and throw rocks and bricks at us after we died to save their lives. And people talk about we are savages.
Mr. Carmichael, if you had the chance to stand up in front of the white community and say anything you desired, say to him, understand me, white man, what would you say?
I would say, understand yourself, white man, that the white man's burden should not have been preached in Africa, but it should have been preached among you, that you need now to civilize yourself. You have moved to destroy and disrupt. You have taken people away. You have broken down their systems. And you have called all that civilization. And we who have suffered at this are now saying to you, you are the killers of the dreams. You are the savages. Yes, it is you who have always been uncivilized. Civilize yourself.
This young man who calls upon the white man to civilize himself had a radical effect on the civil rights movement with his cry of black power. Not only did it produce a predictable reaction in the white community, but it added to the strains within the movement itself. The five leading civil rights groups range from the conservative NAACP and the Urban League to CORE and SNCC, by far the most militant. Although they will not criticize each other publicly, leaders of the various groups inevitably are caught up in a popularity contest, and they are acutely aware of the need to present a public posture of militancy. This summer, Martin Luther King was on the defensive. His open housing drive in Chicago was not getting results, and so the people of SNCC and CORE began to sneer at the fruitless demonstrations and meetings held by Dr. King's Southern Christian Leadership Conference. King's people acknowledged that they needed a victory if there were not to be defections from their forces. That victory finally came when Dr. King threatened to march on the suburban town of Cicero. Chicago's civic leaders feared violence there, so at a hastily assembled summit meeting, they agreed to some concessions, and King called off his march. Through it all, though, he had insisted that no matter what the competition from his more militant black brothers, he would never renounce his policy of nonviolence.
Now what I'm saying is this. I would like for all of us to believe in nonviolence, but I'm here to say tonight that if every Negro in the United States turns against nonviolence, I'm going to stand up as a lone voice and say this is the wrong way.
I will never change in my basic idea that nonviolence is the most potent weapon available to the Negro in his struggle for freedom and justice. I think for the Negro to turn to violence would be both impractical and immoral.
There is an increasingly vocal minority who disagreed totally with your tactics, Dr. King.
There's no doubt about that. I would agree that there is a group in the Negro community advocating violence now. I happen to feel that this group represents a numerical minority. Surveys have revealed this. The vast majority of Negroes still feel that the best way to deal with the dilemma that we face in this country is through nonviolent resistance. And I don't think this vocal group will be able to make a real dent in the Negro community in terms of swaying 22 million Negroes to this particular point of view. And I contend that the cry of black power is at bottom a reaction to the reluctance of white power to make the kind of changes necessary to make justice a reality for the Negro. I think we've got to see that a riot is the language of the unheard. And what is it that America has failed to hear? It has failed to hear that the economic plight of the Negro poor has worsened over the last few years.
How many summers like this one do you imagine that we can expect?
Well, I would say this, we don't have long. The mood of the Negro community now is one of urgency, one of saying that we aren't going to wait, that we've got to have our freedom. We've waited too long. So that I would say that every summer we are going to have this kind of vigorous protest. My hope is that it will be nonviolent. I would hope that we can avoid riots because riots are self-defeating and socially destructive. I would hope that we can avoid riots, but that we will be as militant and as determined next summer and through the winter as we have been this summer. And I think the answer about how long it will take will depend on the federal government, on the city halls of our various cities, and on white America to a large extent. This is where we are at this point, and I think white America will determine how long it will be and which way we go in the future.
Even Senator Jacob Javits asked the question recently. He said that he was a slum.
We want black power! 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 What do you want? What do you want?
Nobody in the town has any use for him. Nobody likes him. Nobody wants him.
We don't want brotherhood. You keep the brotherhood.
The Negro is not the problem. The problem is what Negro connotates, what it stands for. The pigment of skin isn't the problem. The problem is that the Negro in this country today stands for venereal disease, prostitution, the numbers racket, and crime.
CBS reports, Black Power, White Backlash. With CBS News correspondent Mike Wallace.
Summer 1966 was a season of revelation for the white man in the North. For the first time, he began fully to comprehend the intensity of his feelings and his fears about the black man. For years, he had watched, smug and fascinated, as the trials of the Southern black and white were played out for him like some morality play on his television screen. But he remained a spectator, only half involved. Then came summer 1966, and as riots crackled through his cities, the northern white man came to realize the depth of his confusion, his animosity, and fear. Black power was the catalyst, a phrase shouted by a 25-year-old revolutionary on a Mississippi highway. It was a rallying cry to northern blacks mired in frustration and bitterness, a cry that sounded like a threat of violence, of vengeance, to a white man fed up with racial turmoil.
The violence struck not just where it was expected, in the humid ghettos of the major urban centers in Brooklyn, Chicago, Cleveland. Americans were stunned to learn the other unexpected datelines of violence from Amityville, New York to Menlo Park, California. Almost everywhere it began with marches, demonstrations. Then it escalated to looting, Molotov cocktails, and occasionally to a sniper's bullets. The damage hasn't yet been totaled. It will run into the tens of millions. Arrests were in the thousands. The number of persons injured, unrecorded. At least 9 persons were killed. But the most serious casualty of all was the relationship between the black man and the white man. By summer's end, the northern white was counter-marching, counter-demonstrating.
And at the end of summer, white political leaders up and down the nation on all levels were voicing their concern.
I've heard it said that the cause of civil rights has fallen backward in this past year. And those who are critical say that riots and violence have produced new waves of white resistance to further progress. That the civil rights movement itself is rent by factionalism and extremism. And vital civil rights legislation has apparently floundered in the Congress for this session. And political candidates running on a platform of never, never have defeated good men of moderate progressive views. Now, my fellow Americans, I would be less than honest with you if I did not say that in all of this there is some grain of truth.
These guys have been in and out of trouble so much you could fill a book. But unfortunately, the Supreme Court ruling where we have to handle these characters like daffodils instead of the bums that they are, where we could throw them in a jail where they belong, no, we have to tap them on the wrist. Now, the other problem which caused this situation is the NAACP. Their continual announcements of planned demonstrations, their continual announcements of mass meetings has worked these people up in a frenzy, these irresponsible hoodlums who the so-called civil rights workers are working in their behalf for first-class citizenship. Well, I think that NAACP should turn right around and start doing something about demonstrating against these undesirables in their own race and nationality.
I don't think I have ever seen as strong a reactionism as has occurred in Atlanta and in Georgia. I'm perfectly frank and honest about it. It has upset the status quo of established voting patterns in the state of Georgia that never before had been upset. The state went Republican for the first time in the last presidential election. It went that way entirely on the race issue. We will have major changes in the runoffs that are now coming up or in the general election this year. I wouldn't attempt to identify each one of them, but I would say that I have never seen as strong a reaction amongst the white citizen there is at the present time.
That was Ivan Allen, the mayor of Atlanta, Georgia, a leading moderate on racial matters in his native South. He strongly favored and testified in behalf of the 1964 Civil Rights Bill. His city has long been looked on as remarkable for its progress in relations between the races. It is also the home of the national headquarters of SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee.
Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. We want black power. We want black power. We want black power. We want black power.
To Stokely Carmichael, a 25-year-old revolutionary born in the West Indies, educated at the best high school in New York, a college graduate with a degree in philosophy. It was here in Mississippi this summer that Carmichael, with his cry for black power, first became a national figure and to many a frightening one.
Every courthouse in Mississippi ought to be burned down tomorrow to get rid of the dirt and hell. Now from now on, when they ask you what you want, you know what to tell them. What do you want? What do you want? What do you want? Everybody, what do you want?
I talked with Stokely Carmichael one night earlier this month in Atlanta. He wore an African toga given him by Sekou Touré of Guinea, a reminder, he said, of his African heritage.
I think that there's a realization in this country that black power is not just a mere slogan, nationally or internationally. It is real that black people can come together and start determining for their lives how they're going to live and controlling their economic and political lives.
Well, why talk about dynamite sticks if Molotov cocktails won't work? When you talk of black power, building a movement that will smash everything that Western civilization has created, when you say that black power should bring the country to its knees anytime it messes with the black man, and these are quotes from Stokely Carmichael, the picture has got to be, in the mind of white man and black man,
one of a man who threatens violence.
On the contrary, if you say that you have to bring the country to its knees if it messes with a black man, you're saying that the only protection for black people is that they unite. So that when one black man is touched, because he's black, there's some protection for him. Now, it's obvious that that protection does not exist in this country. It does not now exist. And the only people who can have that protection are black people. And black people know that. Now, white people may not know that. So it means that you have to build a movement so strong in this country that if one black man is touched, every black man will rise up and let this country know they're not going to tolerate it.
If one black man is touched.
That's right, because he's black. I mean, if a black man is walking down the streets of Mississippi, down a highway with a Bible in his hand, he is shot because he is black.
That's one incident.
Oh, I can name you a lot of others, and you know that yourself.
In the northern ghettos.
If one black man in California is driving his pregnant wife to the hospital and he is shot by a white racist policeman, I can name you more incidents.
Then you're saying fight violence with violence.
I am saying that we must build a movement of black people that will protect ourselves so that we are willing to stop that by any means necessary. Now, I'm not concerned about the question of violence. It seems to me that that will depend upon how, in fact, white people respond. If white people, in fact, are willing not to bother with black people because they are black, then there's going to be no question of violence.
When you read stories about difficulties, riots in Omaha or Cleveland or Brooklyn or Chicago or wherever.
I call them rebellions.
They're rebellions.
That's right.
And you see nothing wrong with them?
I think that it is people who are rebelling against a system that has locked them inside tight of ghettos, that exploits and oppresses them, and they have no means of redress to break that system down. We intend to build within black people the realization that that problem is not theirs, that's created by white society. It's purposely created by white society, and then they throw it back on us and blame us. That's the first thing we have to create in black people. Then secondly, we have to move to a position where we can control the housing.